Good evening, everyone. Bless you and welcome to the Hour of Truth with the Master Hilarion from our Livingston Sanctuary of the Heart. It's a pleasure to be with you. Let us sing with a video, Glorious Apollo, in honor of the golden ray, the yellow ray, which is an aspect of divine truth. The words will be on the screen with the song, Glorious Apollo.
Such an altar by grace. Thus then combining, heart and hands joining, sing we in harmony Apollo's praise, Apollo's praise, Apollo's praise, Apollo's praise, Apollo's praise. Glorious Apollo, halo beam of wisdom, and beloved Luna, we praise thy flame. Send forth the action our terroring God's holy name. Forward in victory, voices raising glory, sing we in harmony Apollo's praise, Apollo's praise, Apollo's praise, Apollo's praise, Apollo's praise. Glorious Apollo, legions of angels, bring to earth the holy Kumara's light. Teach our children, speak this mighty master, strengthen our armor in battle for the wise. God's banner raising, marching onward praising, sing we in harmony Apollo's praise, Apollo's praise, Apollo's praise, Apollo's praise, Apollo's praise. Glorious Apollo, wisdom's mighty master, conquering the deeds of the fallen ones. Let wisdom pierce the hypocrite and coward, justice through God's daughters and sons. Free we will stay by God's golden way. Sing we in harmony Apollo's praise, Apollo's praise, Apollo's praise, Apollo's praise, Apollo's praise. Glorious Apollo, Helios and Vesta, answer the call of the Elohim, that we may all be Elohim imagined. Cells of Apollo is our dream. As we defy the ascension in the light, sing we in harmony Apollo's praise, Apollo's praise, Apollo's praise, Apollo's praise, Apollo's praise.
Thank you. We have a new prayer, 20.033. And for those of you at home, you can go to the prayer and song page, and specifically the prayer page, and scroll down to 20.033. It should be uploaded now. And it's the prayer to Apollo and Lumina. We will give it after some comments. Hilarion says that he's inviting us to attend a special session at Apollo and Lumina's retreat in Germany, or over Germany, and this is the only Elohimic retreat upon the European continent, although there are other retreats, such as Mother Mary's retreat over Fatima in Portugal, and the Divine Director's, well, a retreat over Transylvania, which I think is kind of shared with Saint Germain and the Divine Director. The Queen of Light's retreat, which is over Bergvik in Sweden, over the home of our beloved Runa and Marita Hagen, and Uriel and Aurora's retreat over Krakow, Poland. Does anybody remember any others in Europe? I think those are the primary ones. So Apollo and Lumina have the only Elohimic retreat. If you consider Russia as part of Europe, which I consider more the Orient, And we have the white ray Elohim of the fourth ray, beloved period in Astraea over Russia. So why is this important now? Because there are planetary changes occurring that require greater illumination for all mankind. People are ignorant of what is really transpiring, and so we can collaborate together with the Elohim to enlighten and illumine mankind by working on strategies to bring the higher teachings of divine truth to a greater and wider audience. Hilarion, with his retreat over Crete, and of course, I think I forgot that one, and also Pallas Athena's retreat over Greece, Hilarion's over Crete. Those are also important retreats of the Emerald Ray, along with Mother Mary's, to anchor a great light of truth, healing, vision, music, etc., for planetary wholeness, for the light of cosmic truth to blaze forth for the illumination and enlightenment of many people. So let's give this prayer a few times. And as we are invited by the Elohim, actually by Hilarion with the approval of the Elohim, it's not often that humanity in their finer bodies can go to the Elohim's retreats, yet this is a special dispensation. And if we pledge to bring illumination and divine knowledge and gnosis, understanding to mankind through our work and service, which I think we do in the Heart Center, because we're all working together toward many, many forms of illumination, it will bode well toward greater intercession, the alleviation of suffering and darkness, and through the enlightenment, people will make less mistakes and they will stay closer to the path of light so that they don't have to continue to re-embody over and over again making the same mistakes. They learn the truth, they learn about reincarnation and karma, they begin to understand all the dynamics of the path so that they can walk in the light of living truth. So let's give this prayer 20.033 for the very first time together. Dear Lumina, Apollo, come and lighten hearts and souls. Blessed Elohim of second ray, your truth to us bestows. Pure knowledge of your wisdom teachings, gnosis of pure mind, with understanding of God's nature meant for all mankind. Apollo, blaze your solar rays, bless Lumina, shine here. Reveal the mysteries of the sun, our higher teachers dear. Dear Lumina, Apollo, blaze the wisdom of the sun. Illumine every sentient being to know with God we're one. Increase the radiance of your wisdom through our beings now. Transmute all darkness with your grace, pure solar joy endow. Apollo, blaze your golden light, bless Lumina, shine here. Reveal the mysteries of the sun, O Elohim, draw near. Dear Lumina, Apollo, come and lighten hearts and souls. Blessed Elohim of second ray, your truth to us bestows. Pure knowledge of your wisdom teachings, gnosis of pure mind, with understanding of God's nature meant for all mankind. Apollo, blaze your solar rays, blessed Lumina, shine here. Reveal the mysteries of the sun, our higher teachers dear. Dear Lumina, Apollo, blaze the wisdom of the sun. Illumine every sentient being to know with God we're one. Increase the radiance of your wisdom through our being. Now transmute all darkness with your grace, pure solar joy endow. Apollo, blaze light, bless Lumina, shine here. Reveal the mysteries of the sun, O Elohim, draw near. Dear Lumina, Apollo, come enlighten hearts and souls. Bless Elohim of second rate, your truth to us bestows. Pure knowledge of your wisdom teachings, gnosis of pure mind, with understanding of God's nature meant for all mankind. Apollo, blaze your solar rays, bless Lumina, shine here. Reveal the mysteries of the sun, our higher teachers dear. Dear Lumina, Apollo, blaze the wisdom of the sun. Illumine every sentient being to know with God we're one. Increase the radiance of your wisdom through our beings now. Transmute all darkness with your grace, pure solar joy endow. Apollo, blaze your golden light, bless Lumina, shine here. Reveal the mysteries of the sun, O Elohim, draw near. Dear Lumina, Apollo, come enlighten hearts and souls. Bless Elohim of second ray, your truth to us. us bestows pure knowledge of your wisdom teachings, gnosis of pure mind, with understanding of God's nature meant for all mankind. Apollo, blazer, solar rays, less lumina, shine here. Reveal the mysteries of the sun, our higher teachers dear. Dear lumina, Apollo, blaze the wisdom of the sun. Illumine every sentient being to know with God we're one. Increase the radiance of your wisdom through our beings now. Transmute all darkness with your grace, pure solar joy endow. Apollo, blaze your golden light, bless lumina, shine here. Reveal the mysteries of the sun, O Elohim, draw near. Dear lumina, Apollo, come enlighten hearts and souls. Bless Elohim of second ray, your truth to us bestows. Pure knowledge of your wisdom teachings, gnosis of pure mind, with understanding of God's nature meant for all mankind. Apollo, blaze your solar rays, bless lumina, shine here. Reveal the mysteries of the sun, our higher teachers dear. Dear lumina, Apollo, blaze the wisdom of the sun. Illumine every sentient being to know with God we're one. Increase the radiance of your wisdom through our beings now. Transmute all darkness with your grace, pure solar joy endow. Apollo, blaze your golden light, bless lumina, shine here. Reveal the mysteries of the sun, O Elohim, draw near. Although we are absolutely a pink ray movement of divine love, the heart center, we're also a movement of Buddhic mindfulness through all of our beautiful Buddha rosaries, through the illumination flame of Meru University, through all the teachings that come forth, both through me, yet also through all of you. And many in this room have taught Meru University classes. Raise your hand if you've taught a class at Meru University. Yeah. And raise your hand if you'd like to teach a class at some point. Yeah. Okay. And even if you didn't raise your hand, you may end up teaching a class. Because we are a movement of progressive revelation and divine understanding and holy theosophia or holy wisdom, it's incumbent upon each of us to walk in this light of the golden liquid light of the sun and help to illumine people through what we teach. Some of you have been teachers in this room, not just through Meru University, through schools. So you have within your causal body aspects of how to teach, how to present, how to get the attention of and get the mindfulness of your students to actually latch on to the concepts, the understandings that you try to convey through what you have taught. It's a very complex equation in some respects because you're dealing with students of all different levels of awareness, consciousness, abilities, and propensities. Yet, a true teacher has the gift of both discernment and of tongues because he or she can discern what each student requires at their level of understanding based on their upbringing, everything, all the factors of their life. And through this gift of tongues, you're able to speak to students at their level so that they can actually cognize, understand the lesson plan, what you are trying to convey and offer. And so you may not have thought that you have these gifts of the Holy Spirit, but I can assure you, many of you as teachers have developed these gifts of both discernment, wisdom, knowledge, and the gift of tongues, because all of these, especially these four gifts, are inextricably woven into the fabric of what you do as a teacher, to convey understanding and light within that understanding. So celebrate the fact that you have, if you are a true teacher, a loving teacher, you love your students, you have honored them by your love, by your understanding of their nature as well as their mind, their inner faculties as well as their abilities to grasp the lessons and master them. True teachers are psychologists too. They understand the nature of the soul as it is attempting to accept and master these lessons and these life learning modalities. And when you move and have your being within a classroom, or whether it's inside or outside, and I think in the future many more classrooms will be outside in nature, you have the ability to use nature as a divine resource to convey principles, values, concepts, and illumined engrams that will actually spring forth from within their being these beautiful, beautiful seeds of light that when they sprout later in life, as they apply what they learn, they will come into higher energy fields of awareness, consciousness, divine mindfulness. So all along, some of you as teachers have been actually helping your students actualize. You've actually been helping them actualize who they are as sentient beings, moving toward their divinity, moving toward God consciousness, moving into light fields that through your beautiful hearts and beautiful minds, you usher them toward these awakening experiences. It's probably one of the greatest treasures of a teacher to see a student awaken to an understanding of a concept that they had never before realized as valuable, as true, as worthy of their soul to actually ingest and become and master. And you as a teacher, I know many of you have had this experience again and again where your students went through these awakening processes, and it was such a beautiful and heartening thing for you to observe it. And again, another beautiful thing is to observe your students collaborating with one another on projects where they had to work together to do something as a group, as a unit, rather than only individually. Because what happens in that situation, your students have to, in this cooperation, give and take, share and receive. They have to understand the dynamics of how another person's mind and brain and heart works in order for that person to be a part of the same alchemy of the process of group learning that is absolutely essential for life, because we live in many groups. We live in families. We live in our fields of endeavor through our vocation, our work. We live in greater communities where we live. There are other groups, you know, sporting groups and teams and going to the gym, or, you know, other collaborative groups now through all manner of opportunities over the internet and Facebook groups, etc. There's so many different groups now. And each group is an opportunity for give and take and for the light of truth to emerge, because we become brighter when we are illumined within a shared experience of life. We become brighter when we are illumined through a shared experience in life, Hilarion says. And the brighter and brighter we become because we share in these awakening and illumining experiences is a magical process. It is something that is so sublime and beautiful when we reflect on it later and we come to the realization that it took all of us to come to this collective realization. In group projects in the Heart Center, this happens all the time as we collaborate toward one purpose. Our meetings, planning and coordinating and then out picturing events, Meru University courses, projects that we are creating something together. All the time we are using our mind and our mindfulness in this collaborative work to engender what? Truth emerging. And through that truth, personal divine gnosis, planetary divine awakening and self-realization, and ultimately the ascension of every man, woman, and child on the earth. So please never discount yourself as being a teacher and a representative of both the green ray and the yellow ray, because when you are within this process of coordinating, collaborating, and cooperating to bring forth a creative endeavor and an offering to the world, there is that wisdom light that descends over the collective of you through the mind of God that is there, because really it is a mind meld, a cosmic heart and mind meld. And maybe, you know, we've called it these projects where we work, we have heart mapping now, we have mind mapping, but we used to call them mind, what's that? Mastermind alliances. Now we call them master heart alliances, or maybe we could say master heart mind alliances, because we realize that the heart wisdom is just as important as the mind wisdom. So in our movement, we are moving into the Aquarian age as an age of love wisdom, mindfully, heart-centeredly, to use the collective heart mind of every disciple, every initiate, as part of this process of planetary liberation, awakening, enlightenment, self-realization, and the ascension. So the masters have encouraged us within Meru University to have many of you as presenters. And one thing we are going to be doing this year is having these little short presentations that we are calling MUMS, right? MUMS, M-U-M-S. And that's short for?
Meru University Mini-Talks.
Jenny says Meru University Mini-Talks. So you're going to be learning about these as people step forward, encouraged by our Meru University team to give short, maybe 10, 15-minute presentations. Jenny's pointing at Ray. So he's a ray of light, by the way. Mm-hmm. And so we're going to be having these throughout this year. What will happen as a result of this? Many iconic aspects of truth will descend through that one's heart and mind, through the presentation, that will give us insights into the path, into life, into the teachings, into that person's experience of God within their being and life, their experience of the path, of the way, and the truth that they have walked within under their Christ self, under their I Am presence, and it will actually facilitate through that one's heart a group awakening. It will facilitate a group awakening, which is like this puff of golden light and maybe emerald light that will help each person to make progress in the path. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing. I'm looking forward to it because I always relish and enjoy when you present and share your insights and your enlightened, self-realized points on the path, because it demonstrates to me that you get it, that you understand what the masters have encouraged us to do, what they continually pour out through their heart streams of these engrams of light that they seed us with. And then when you actually water that seed and it sprouts, and then you can share some cosmic impulse or enlightened aspect of the teachings or the path, this brings me to ecstasy, I have to tell you. This is like one of the greatest things that I feel and I observe when you get it and when you are really there at the crux of this point of illumination. And I think as teachers, those of you who have been teachers, it's the same thing with you, what I shared earlier. It's such a joyous thing you know, to reflect. Maybe you're grading a paper, and the beauty of the mindfulness of a student comes through what that student wrote, or maybe they printed it, maybe what they drew, maybe it's a music project, whatever it is. It's like it's you become godlike in that moment, celebrating the great godness within that child or that human. And how can you get closer to God than to witness the creativity, the co-creativity of a soul with the divine one? I don't know that there's much greater bliss that you can have than to be at that nexus point of experiencing the richness of the spirit that emerges from within a soul that edifies that being when they are a creative, when they are a poet, a writer, an artist, whatever. So I think you understand where Hilarion's coming from tonight. Tonight we're having a little different type of service, and I hope we can have a little bit of joy tonight. So if you have a jovial release, a joke, whatever you'd like to share, we'll have time for that tonight. Hilarion shared with me just a few little tidbits, kind of like little Zen statements before our service. Good fortune awaits the truthful. Good fortune awaits the truthful. You know, when you're not truthful, you know that there's going to be a karmic recompense. And so, but yet to put this in a positive vein, good fortune awaits the truthful. Because when you're truthful, it elicits from the universe the emerald ray through your stand for the truth. And that emerald ray, in all of its aspects, whether it's health and vitality, wellness, whether it's good fortune, abundance, even opulence, whether it's the music of the spheres and the beautiful harmonies and melodies of light from the etheric planes, or whether it's the actual light of truth itself, those emerge when you are truthful, when you are real. He says, we phase you into higher consciousness. So we've seen this word phase vis-a-vis the Elohim of the five crystal rays, right? Well, what does that mean? Well, we go through phases of enlightenment and awakening to higher consciousness. So they phase us into higher consciousness. We must be willing to be phased. And just as the moon goes through its phases every 28, 29 days, we go through our phases. Hopefully, we're more in tune with the sun than just the moon, although the moon is important for our soul, the sun representing the I Am presence more. We phase you into higher consciousness. So I see in this sense, they're using the sun's phases because the sun has phases too. And I think we'll learn more and more of those phases as we become more enlightened. He also says, reality is your fully aligned state with God truth. So when we incorporate God truth in our life, we come into our reality, which is our divine presence. We can only really be real when we're aligned with God. We can only be totally real when we live in the truth of our divine nature. So truth leads directly to reality. And many people live a feigned life where they're always trying to please others or be something that somebody else will revere or appreciate or cherish or celebrate. I think that we choose to do all these things for God, because when we give God the glory, when we desire to be pleasing to God, the Divine One, we can more easily align with our reality through the light of God truth. So these are just three statements. There could be many more, you know, throughout the night if I just meditated a little longer. Would anybody like to reflect on anything that the Master has already shared through me about teaching, or maybe an experience you had as a teacher when a child or even an adult kind of awakened to some beautiful state of awareness? If so, It can be in front of a microphone. I know Mona taught for over 20 years. Terry taught for what, 30 years? 28. 28 years, just retired. Others of you have taught classes. Marlena, Rayfield teaches a fair amount. And Christopher's always teaching on cosmic love, you know. Pontificating and teaching both, you know. Okay, so who'd like to say something? Dean's encouraging her. I think Mona has a story about a student coming into an awakened state. Would you like to? Okay, first Cindy and then Mona. By the way, while we're getting her, the power went out at our house today at 5:15 till 6:30. So we got a little taste of what it would be like if we go through 3 days or 10 days of darkness. Okay, so Cindy, I think we're ready for Cindy.
Okay, so I still teach Pineal Basset classes, except for not during the COVID. And it's usually women, older women, but I get young kids sometimes and a guy or two every once in a while. And I was in Baja teaching a pretty large class. And the money exchange is different, you know. So I was doing like 20 pesos to the dollar or something like that. And maybe it should have been like 19.5 or something like this. And this one woman says she just couldn't believe that I was going to charge 20 pesos to the dollar. And so she said something very pretty derogative toward me, you know, right at the beginning of the class, like, I can't believe you're like that, you know, and I just go, ooh. So for the rest of the class, I just radiated love to her. I was just there for her and just, you know, I was just radiated love because that's the only way I was going to be able to deal with it. It was just to, you know, be there and love her to death, love her so that she, so it didn't bother me that, you know, she kind of, you know, put me down at the beginning. So I was enlightened. And I find that I do that more often than not when I feel like somebody's, you know, not in line with me or I'm not in line with them. I just love them. And then that really, really enlightens me. And I think it also helps them, too. It made a really difference in the class because other people heard it, too. You know, so I was just happy that I was able to.
Did she thank you at the end?
Yes.
Oh, good.
Yes, she did. She was very appreciative, you know. And every time, you know, we might for like the first couple of hours really work on the baskets. And then I'll ask everybody to go around the room and talk about themselves. So I ask her a lot of questions about herself. And it was just it's kind of like a knitting bee type thing, you know. So it's a lot of things that you said tonight really, you know, goes well with how I teach.
Great. Thank you, Cindy.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, Christopher's in front of a mic, and then we'll get one in front of Mona. So go ahead, Christopher.
You should really let her mention my name if you don't.
Okay. Oops.
Okay. I was going to say, you really shouldn't mention my name if you want to keep me invisible. But I was going to share that I've kind of been playing the role of a teacher. And sometimes I say that I'm Dr. Rudy. Of course, the meaning of teacher is, or of doctor is teacher. If you get into the Latin root, the original meaning of it. So I played the role the last 12 years as the host of Cosmic Love, and it's been a process. It's changed me definitely. You know, try being the host of Cosmic Love for 12 years. You'll do a number on your head. But so it's the old, you know, you can't drive or steer a car until you get it in motion. And becoming a teacher is a process whereby by doing it, you kind of learn how to do it, and you kind of you know, you like driving a car, you're trending into the future and there's curves in the road ahead and you've got to steer in the right direction. And it's a process that always, you know, with the Ascended Mastermind Alliance, you've got, you know, the, I call it the A team, the Ascent team. And then you've got your regular Mastermind Alliance, which is your list. You know, in my case, I used to have about 10,000 people on my list, and I would talk about light and love and keep it, you know, metaphoric. And now it's down to about 5,000 because I've got into being a serious truth teller. And people over the, and that kind of goes with the territory, but, you know, it's like when I'm preaching to the choir now, it's a pretty solid choir. So it's an ongoing experience. I call it conscious evolution, revolution, revelations.
So have you had a student experience where you helped awaken somebody and they came back and said something to you?
Oh, I get, you know, the response that's part of the process. It's like, it's an ongoing. And sometimes people I haven't heard from for years and really don't know who they are. They've signed up at one time on the list. It's all automated now. But they'll contact me and they'll make it very clear that I misspelled something in a blog I just put out, or the syntax or the content, or they'll send me videos and articles that are related to what I just published, you know, because it's an ongoing blogging process and it's been really intense this last month. Now new videos come out daily where I'd look for really good truth-telling videos come out weekly, or before, you know, beginning of the year it was like monthly if you got a really few really good videos, you know. But now there's like it's really a revolution in higher consciousness worldwide. You know, people are waking up, and a lot of people you'd never heard of, I've never, all of a sudden their astrology, psychology is just right or whatever, but they're like lucid in sharing something that I don't care where it's from, but if they're speaking truth, or, you know, if there's a lot of light, it's something worth, you know.
We're gonna cut you off because I'd like to get other people the opportunity to share. But that's great. I like the fact that the new videos are coming out daily. Hundreds of them.
Yeah,
and so truth is happening.
And there's certain networks, there's certain sources. And actually a piece I'm just doing right now is all these different sources I've learned, and I've been getting it from different people, you know, the sources to look at.
Okay. Yeah. That's good. Okay. Mona, I'm sorry, but I have to adjust here.
Okay.
And then Nancy, I think, is next. Oh, okay. Raphael, maybe after that.
Okay. I've really been blessed to be able to teach every grade, kindergarten through eighth grade, but there's certain years that really stand out. And just to give you a little background about the incident that I'd like to share, I was hired by the Great Falls Public School District to teach an integrated, hands-on, multi-age curriculum with required parent participation. And none of the teachers wanted to apply for it. I was so happy. But there were hundreds that applied for it outside of the district, and I was really lucky to have that because of the relationships you form with the parents and with the students. So that sets the stage. And I had the parents in the classroom this particular day and, you know, scheduled them in throughout the month. And what the kids did is they each chose an animal that they really wanted to learn about. And my goal as a teacher was for them to experience learning where it becomes internal and it's a joy and they can have the desire to learn beyond the classroom. So this particular day, the parents were there and it was set up for success because I had kindergarten, first and second grade together. I mean, it was an experiment with the district. And so I wanted to do research, and they wanted to do research, and they wanted to learn about animals, and they didn't know how to read. So I'm not going to tell you too much about the organization, but it was, like I said, set up for their success. Well, we were so excited, and the kids, you know, every two kids, there was one parent there to support them, and they'd get books, and maybe they could only read a word or two, but they would pick out information, and they'd write it down, or if they couldn't write, they'd draw a picture, and they were collecting all this information. There was so much excitement in the room. Everybody was just spread out all over with their papers and books, and then we realized that we forgot about lunch. We forgot to go to lunch. So here's this kindergartners, first and second graders, so excited about what they were doing and what they were learning that we totally forgot about it. And I'd say the rewards I got were the parents, well, the kids excelling throughout the district, you know, in my classroom and then wherever they went afterwards. And the parents' gratitude was huge. So teaching for me is about relationships and developing those positive relationships that you have for life.
Thank you, Mona. Okay. I guess Marlene is next. She's
What teaching taught me was that you really don't teach anyone anything. As the instructor or the one who is sharing the information, you find that key that unlocks and opens the creativity and the excitement within the person, that passion, if you will. You find that key that opens that door, that unlocks for them whatever form it may be. So it's more like, instead of being a teacher, it's more like being a Sherlock Holmes and finding the mystery within that little one and helping it to become alive.
Thank you. Beautiful. Hey, Raphael, did you want to say anything?
So in 2001, I was able to begin a Tai Chi Chuan class in the park. First time everything like that has ever been done in my hometown of Mount Vernon, New York. And I had sometimes up to 30 people would show up. It was free, but the Department of Recreation paid me. And I had all age groups. There was one lady in particular after about a couple of months of studying with me. She approached me one day and she said, Coach Fitch, I had diabetes and high blood pressure and I couldn't return to my home the way I came from my home because coming from my home, it was down the hill to come to the park, but I couldn't go back up the hill. I had to go around on more flatter terrain to get home because I didn't have the energy to get back home. But after taking your class, I went to my doctor one day and I told him that I was studying Tai Chi. And he said, your sugar is balanced, your blood pressure is balanced, and what have you been doing? And so she shared with me that now, after about a month or two of coming to my classes, she could actually go up the hill to her home without having trouble breathing or anything of that nature. So that was quite interesting. You never know sometimes, well, you can know, what people are going through internally when you're sharing with them. And sometimes you get surprises like that, which are encouraging. So that was encouraging for me as a teacher.
Beautiful, beautiful. Okay, Terry, I know you've got at least a few stories. 28 years of teaching, you got to have a couple good ones.
Okay, so I also taught kinder through fifth. I was fortunate to be able to teach a lot of the grades. And when you address the subject of the teacher's not solely a teacher, you're a psychologist, you're a therapist. you're the minister, you're the mommy, you're the daddy. I mean, I had a lot of roles that I felt year by year, depending upon what the child needed, you know, I was inspired to give that child. And it's kind of like what Marlena said, you're unlocking something in that child that maybe they don't even know they need. So one particular instance that I'll just share with, I taught fourth and fifth grade predominantly, and I had a student that was taken out of my classroom, and she was put into another teacher's classroom because they took a whole group of kids and they were switching around kids to make the numbers work out right. It was a bureaucratic mess, but they didn't take into consideration the sensitivity of the children. It was like something a principal did and didn't really think about how that might affect a child if she was with one teacher for a certain amount of time and then was taken out and given to another teacher. So I had what was called the gifted cluster, and those children they're special needs children. They're very sensitive, and they're very aware and very alert. And anyway, she was put into another teacher's classroom that she didn't have the same disposition as that teacher, and that teacher and her clashed. And she started throwing tantrums, like really big. She was going through a lot at home. Her parents were going through a divorce, and her big brother was taking it all out on her. So that's what I mean by psychologist. So and therapist, you end up in a lot of roles. Anyway, she was out on the balcony of the other teacher's classroom, and she was on her stomach kicking and screaming and yelling. And this is a big girl. She's almost as tall as me, fourth grader. And they said, oh my God, call the principal, call the vice principal, call a coordinator, somebody, we have to do something. And she must be taken out of the school. She's losing it. And they came and got me. And I walked over to her and called her by her name. And she stood up off of the floor where she was throwing a tantrum and kicking in the balcony. And I just put my arms around her and I just held her. And she sobbed and she sobbed and she cried. And she calmed down. And then she said, I just can't be in that class. Can you take me back into your room? And so the bureaucracy let go of their, you know, holdings on her, and they put her back in my classroom, and she was able to flourish. She was able to do her writing and her reading and her math, and she was able to really shine. So that's like one of many students that, you know, if you're not paying attention to the needs of that one child, they just fall through the cracks in the bureaucracy and they don't even notice it. So I felt like encircling her with love is exactly what she needed, and that kind of snapped her out of her tantrum that she was throwing. So
thank you, Terry. Beautiful, beautiful. Okay, anybody else? Okay, Boyd. And if there's, by the way, if there's anybody online, I'm sure there's some teachers out there.
I'm getting there.
There we go.
So I have a great thirst for knowledge, and one of the smartest things I've ever done is agree to teach. And, you know, really all it did, all it required was the courage to get up there. And one of the biggest takeaways for me is that if you agree to be a teacher of something, even if you don't already know it from reading in a book or something like that, and if you're willing to just meditate on it, organize your thoughts, write down notes, and just translate what we call downloads, you'll get a lot of extra teaching that you can't get anywhere else. If I had to quantify what I've got from books and then from dictations and then what I've gotten as a direct result of gifts of the Holy Spirit of understanding and knowledge because I agreed, I mean, I've probably given about at least 60 or 70 talks on meditation and all kinds of things. New, unique things come to you because you have the courage to get up there. And the great benefit of just doing it repetitively is because you get better and better and better at translating the download into memorable portions and then organizing your thoughts and then thinking of ways to do some of it humorously and relating it to people's situations and things like that, making it very memorable for them. And, you know, the whole skill of that, it's just like, you know, like pumping weights. You get better and better. All you have to do is say yes. Right. Right, David?
Advertise, yeah.
Yeah. So doing one per year, okay, but that's, if you just do it a lot more, it gets easier and more fun, and you gain a lot. That's my
message. You get to the point where the Holy Spirit comes. Yep. I didn't prepare anything for tonight. I surrender, and I show up, right? That's what Mother used to say. I don't know how to take a dictation. I just show up, and the Holy Spirit uses you. So I encourage all of you to have the guts of the Holy Spirit to get to teach and to share, because you will be surprised what comes through you. You'll be absolutely surprised. It's beautiful. Okay. Any sharing online before we sing another song? If not, we'll sing something and then... Okay. Let's sing to Lord Maitreya. He is the former world teacher who's now... Now we have three that took his place. 20.010, Maitreya's loving kindness. He's a planetary Buddha and cosmic Christ, right? Cosmic Christ and planetary Buddha. He's a pretty awesome guy. There he is right there, Lord Maitreya. Here we go.
Resplendent one in whom the light of loving kindness flows. With each out-breath the world you bless with mercy from your heart. And from your mind the golden sun of wisdom you impart. I am the light of loving kindness, Maitreya, Maitreya. See complete. This is an age of golden peak, all honored with true love. Now bless each beating heart with your compassion from above. I am the peace of loving kindness, Maitreya, Maitreya. I am the flow of cosmic wisdom, Maitreya.
Okay. I appreciate another person in our movement who teaches through her creativity. That's Maria Min, who composed, I believe, the music to that song. And what a collaboration. I wrote the prayer. Maria did the music. Dean Anderson helped put it all together. We had our group sing it. And then Maria, I believe, did the video too. What a collaboration, you know, each step of the way. You know, if Maria hadn't done the music, we wouldn't have this beautiful video. If Dean hadn't orchestrated it with the beautiful, beautiful arrangement, orchestration with his, I would say Dean's cosmic mind, I'm going to acclaim it for him, mm-hmm. his cosmic mind, we wouldn't have that beautiful video. And then, you know, Maria's, the perfection, all those beautiful images. I mean, this is a collaboration. So even through a creative song or a video, teaching comes forth, because every time we sing that, we enter into the spirit of it again, and Maitreya's wisdom teaching comes right into our awareness. Beautiful, beautiful. Okay, so thank you, Hilarion, for tonight. Let's see if you'd like to say any final words, any little quips. Well, he says, mindfulness facilitates the joys of inner truth's awakening. Mindfulness facilitates the joys of inner truth's awakenings. So being mindful, as we talked about a little bit in this prayer, facilitates this joy spirit. I mean, remember, he's the laughing Buddha too, right? So what does he laugh about? I think he's laughing to encourage us to become enlightened. He's seeing our enlightened state and laughing about the fact that, you know, why haven't you accepted your enlightenment yet, you know? You can do that through joy. And so that's really, I love that. He also says, Hilarion, that loving kindness is truth, exemplified through the Holy Spirit's presence. Loving kindness is truth, exemplified through the Holy Spirit's presence. And remember, who is the twin flame of the Maha Chohan, Pallas Athena? So this loving kindness that Maitreya has originates from really a cosmic mind. He's the cosmic Christ, planetary Buddha. He has a cosmic mind and cosmic Christ consciousness. So loving kindness must be such an important virtue that it helps facilitate enlightenment. And when you're enlightened, you live in all truth. When you're enlightened, you live in all truth. You haven't just awakened to that truth, you live in all truth when you're fully enlightened. You can be awakened, you can be illumined, yet when you're enlightened, you live in all truth. That's a definition from the Master Hilarion about what enlightenment really is. You live in all truth. So thank you for being with us tonight. I think we'll end with a little prayer from the green section. Let's turn to my female buddy in heaven, Maida, 50.035, Maida's Miracle Magic Prayer, 50.035. I think we had a song to this, but I think one day we'll have it edited and ready to go. Didn't we do it? I've got notes all over here that we sang it. Okay, here we go. Miracle magic of pure mystic light, bless every child with your radiance so bright. Protect and lead them to right livelihood, to opt for choices that bring only good. Educate all with your wisdom and love, knowledge and truth that proceed from above. Safeguard their lives with all Venus bestows, so that their oneness with God ever grows. Seal every child with your radiance so bright. Miracle magic of pure mystic light. Miracle magic of pure mystic light. Bless every child with your radiance so bright. Protect and lead them to right livelihood, to opt for choices that bring only good. Educate all with your wisdom and love, knowledge and truth that proceed from above. Safeguard their lives with all Venus bestows, so that their oneness with God ever grows. Seal every child with your radiance so bright. Miracle magic of pure mystic light. Miracle magic of pure mystic light. Bless every child with your radiance so bright. Protect and lead them to right livelihood, to opt for choices that bring only good. Educate all with your wisdom and love, knowledge and truth that proceed from above. Safeguard their lives with all Venus bestows, so that their oneness with God ever grows. Seal every child with your radiance so bright. Miracle magic of pure mystic light. Thank you. God bless you, and have a wonderful rest of your evening.